Random House Audio presents 2 a.m. at the Cat's Pajamas by Marie-Helene Bertino. Read for you by Angela Goethals. Yes, Philadelphia is horrible, but in a very interesting way. There were places there that had been allowed to decay, where there was so much fear and crime that just for a moment, there was an opening to another world. David Lynch. It is dark, dark, 7 a.m. on Christmas Eve Eve. Snow flurries fall in the city. Actors walking home from a cast party on Broad Street try to catch them on their tongues. The ingenue lands a flake on her hot cheek and erupts into a fit of laughter. In Fishtown, a nightmare trembles through the nose and paws of a dog snoozing under construction flats. The Rittenhouse Square fountain switches to life with a pronouncement of water, while Curtis Hall musicians, late for final rehearsal, arpeggiate through the park. The flurries somersault, reconsider, double back. The Ninth Street alleys bear witness as they softly change their minds. Mrs. Rose Santiago, shawl knotted beneath her chin, uses a broom to convince them away from her stoop. They refuse to land. She sweeps uselessly at the air. In her room, at the prow of her father's apartment, Madeleine Altimari practices the shimmy. Shoulders, shoulders, shoulders. In front of the mirror, so she can judge herself, face sharp with focus. It is the world's most serious shimmy. After 30 seconds, a flamingo-shaped timer trills and hops on its plastic legs. Madeleine stops shimmying and rejoins a menthol 100, dozing in an ashtray on her vanity. She exhales. Again. On the record player, Blossom Deary says she's alive, she's awake, she's aware. Shoulders, shoulders, shoulders. After 30 seconds, the timer trills again. Madeleine frowns at herself in the mirror. Terrible. On a list by the ashtray, she marks 1 minute next to the shimmy, followed by a pert C minus. She drags on the cigarette. The other categories, singing, scales, guitar, are unmarked. Madeleine is 2 days away from being 10. She wears a clothespin on her nose and the uniform for St. Anthony of the Immaculate Heart. A maroon sweater over a gray jumper, over a gold shirt, over a training bra with lemon-colored stitching, thick maroon tights. She is number 3 in fifth grade height ordered lineups, behind Maisie, whose spine is shaped like a question mark, and Susan, the daughter of ballerinas. She read somewhere a clothespin worn religiously will shrink her unignorable nose. She thinks the occasional glimmers she can see through her window are snow flurries. She has trouble spelling the word rhythm. She likes when people in movies go to see movies. She cannot understand why the dime is worth more than the fatter, wider nickel. She needs a haircut. Her favorite singer is Blossom Deary, and her favorite bass is upright. She spent the previous night dreaming of apples. She smokes Newport menthols from the carton her mother was smoking when she died the previous year. Eggs cuss and snap on the kitchen stove. The unofficial rule of St. Anthony of the Immaculate Heart is that Madeleine is never allowed to sing again in church or at any assembly. Never, never a whole page of nevers. Even though she had nothing to do with what happened at the previous year's winter assembly, still, it is going to be a gold star day. She will suffer through Claire Kelly's singing in morning mass, the girl's nasal notes and plosive P's filling the church with godless noise, spritzing the first row of pews with every heretical T. But then, her class will be making caramel apples. Madeleine has never had a caramel apple, and she wants to taste one more than she wants God's love. Claire, the sound Madeleine's toilet makes when it's dry. Madeleine is forever adding water to its basin when it wails from the purpose-specific can she keeps under the sink. Like a comet, a horrific afterthought, A roach darts down the wall. Its path follows indecipherable logic. Madeline screams in high C and crushes the cigarette. She pivots, rips a paper towel from a roll on her nightstand. The roach halts, teasing coordinates out of the air with its antennae. It senses her and is rendered paralyzed by options. Madeline closes her eyes, makes the sound of a train whistle on a prairie, and squeezes. Ninth Street Market roaches are full and round like tomatoes. This one leaves a mark on the wall, but most of it gets flushed down the toilet. She scrubs her hands, breathes in and out. Every day, more and more roaches. Every time she kills one, Madeline worries she's a bad person. Stop worrying, she instructs herself. It's time to sing. She changes the record and releases the clothespin from her nose. She locks eyes with herself in the mirror and waits for the music to start. Madeline sings. My name is Blossom. I was raised in a lion's den. One hand is perched on her hip, while the other swings back and forth, keeping time. Tucked into the mirror of her vanity, a picture of her mother singing, one hand on her hip, the other swinging back and forth in time. Her mother was a dancer and singer, whose voice could redirect the mood of a room. My nightly occupation is stealing other women's men. After the cancer spread to her lymph nodes, Madeline's mother filled a recipe box with instructions on how to do various things she knew she wouldn't be around to teach her. How to make a fist, how to change a flat, how to write a thank you note for a gift you hate, how to be efficient. Whenever you are doing one thing, ask yourself, what else could I be doing? On one recipe card, Madeline's mother listed the rules of singing. The number one rule, know yourself. Madeline knows she frowns in the silence between lines. She knows if she straightens her spine, she can hit more notes than if she hunches. She knows she makes up in full-throatedness what she lacks in technical ability. She knows how to harmonize with anything, with someone talking, that harmony is what melody carries in its pocket. She can burrow into a line of music and search out unexpected melodies. She can scat. She knows she scats better if she has eaten a light breakfast. She knows an empty orb hovers inside her, near where the ovaries are drawn on the foldout in her health textbook, the diaphragm. In the diaphragm, the weather is always 70 degrees and sunny. Unable to be shaken even when she shakes. Madeline has trained herself to, when she falters on a high note, clasp the reins of her diaphragm and gather. The song is over. In her flamingo notebook, Madeline marks Blossom's Blues next to singing. The scatting was flat, but had soul. B minus, she writes. The eggs are ready. She slides them onto a plate and adds a square of toast and a spoonful of jam. She holds her breath as she steps into her father's bedroom. He is sleeping, his back toward her. She clears medicine bottles, an ashtray, a half-empty glass of water, to make space for the plate on his dresser. Normally, she leaves his breakfast and skedaddles. However, this morning, she wants to feel close to something. She places her hand on his arm. It moves up and down in sleep. Madeline breathes in and out in time. Eggs, she whispers. In her bedroom, she peers through the curtains to confirm that the glimmers are flurries. Using mittens, boots, a scarf, and an umbrella, Madeline turns herself into a warm, dry house. 7:10 a.m. In the back bedroom of the Kelly family's row home, Claire Kelly plaits her second perfect braid. She administers advice to her little sister, who sits on the bed transfixed. Claire is proud of herself for allowing Alyssa to pal around. She can learn from Claire's mistakes, not that there have been many, and her achievements, which have been plentiful, praise God. Student of the week, month, and year certificates pose on her wall. Claire finishes the braid with a pink barrette and admires herself. The barrettes will reflect the light of St. Anthony's stained glass when Father Gary announces, "Claire Kelly will now lead us in the responsorial."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.